Hey everybody, this is Michael yet again, and welcome back to another video. Well guys, today we went out and saw the film Riddick. And Riddick was directed by David Twohy. This is the same guy that directed the first two films. So when I saw the trailers for this film, I thought, man, you know, this film looks pretty good. I was really wanting to see it. But at the same time, really tempering my expectations, you know, after being burned by certain films, Man of Steel. I don't really expect a whole lot from a trailer anymore. As a matter of fact, I kind of subsided in doing trailer reactions because, you know, really, what can you tell by a trailer? It's just a lot of action scenes put together that don't really reveal the flavor of the movie for the most part. But the Riddick one, I kind of thought, well, you know, it's directed by the same guy that did the first two films. He knows the character. So, you know, when you have the same director directing a franchise, there's been two films, and, you know, I've enjoyed both films. I kind of felt a little bit secure in the fact that, well, you know, even if it's a bad film, he would still, for the most part, get the character right and generally make a decent, entertaining film, because there's a lot of B-movies that I don't consider to be great films, but at the same time, they're entertaining. So a lot of times, you know, I'm just going into a movie and I just want to be entertained. Now, before I begin, guys, let me say that a lot of you have asked me for a trailer reaction on the new film, RoboCop. And I'm not going to do one, guys, because I have seen the trailer. But it's like I say, what can you tell about a trailer? And there's been so many reaction videos to RoboCop. It's just that I don't want to get caught all up in, you know, RoboCop. I mean, I love the original film. And the remake, I'll give it a shot. I don't go into any movie hoping it's a bad movie. So I hope the remake is good, but at the same time, I'm very, very leery of the film. And I'm already starting to feel burned out about watching the movie because there's been so many reactions about the film. All I can say is I hope it's a good movie. But anyway, Riddick. Well, guys, this film takes place like 5 years after the last film. There's even a flashback from the last film with Carl Urban. And basically, at the beginning of this movie, Riddick's just under a lot of rubble. He's under all these rocks. And later on in the film, we find out through flashbacks how he got there. You remember in the last film, he was like the ruler of those religious zealots. Well, you know, in this film, the flashback tells us that he's tired of being the ruler. He just wants to go home to his own people. And Carl Urban's character is the only one that has the information as to where his planet is, where his people come from. So he tells him, okay, we'll take you there if I am made ruler of my people. So Carl Urban wants to be ruler of the religious crazy. So they make a deal, and they give Riddick a ship, and they take him to his home world. But of course, in the film, we find out that they have betrayed him. Now, either they don't know where the home world is, or they just want to get rid of him. So they take him to this planet, betray him, and we learn that that's how he got on this desolate world. And basically, they maroon him there and leave him there. Now, at the beginning of the film, Riddick's one of his legs is broken. He's in bad shape. And the film focuses on him trying to survive. Basically, there's killer canines on the planet. There's these scorpion-like creatures. It's a really desolate world, and we kind of, the film kind of shows us how Riddick pulls himself together and traverses this planet until he comes to this abandoned mercenary outpost. So he goes in, and there's an emergency beacon where he can call for help. But during this time, before this moment, he adopts this puppy, this alien, more or less an alien dog. He feeds it, trains it, and it becomes really loyal to him. So he has this dog not only for companionship, but for protection. So he takes the dog along with him, and he realizes that if he activates this beacon, it's going to bring mercenaries there. And that's what he does. It scans his body, gives out his identity, and there's a bounty on his head, of course, and two ships show up to one ship wants to take him back, and we find out that Riddick's worth more dead than he is alive. The bounty is higher if you kill him. And the other ship, the captain of that ship is the father of the lead mercenary in the first film, And he just wants to know how'd his son die if Riddick killed him. So that's his main reason for being there. And he's also the mercenary that is better equipped, better outfitted. He has more advanced equipment and weapons. And the lesser mercenaries are led by this guy named Santana, who's his mercenaries are more roguish, more untrustworthy. They have no honor. And they'd be the types that you'd have to keep an eye out for because you can't trust them. Johns, the better of the mercenaries, decides he's going to sit back and just watch Santana's men try to capture Riddick. You know, he's warning them, you really think you're going to be able to catch Riddick? You're going to need my help. And, you know, Santana's like, no, I don't need your help. I know what I'm doing. And, of course, Riddick gets the better hand on the situation. He steals a couple of their power nodes from each ship. They can't take off without these power nodes. And then, when they're stranded on the planet, Riddick's like, you know, I'm going to let you guys leave this planet, but at the same time, leave me one ship. You guys take the other one. I'll give you back the power nodes. And, of course, it's never that simple because we see this storm coming. And this rainstorm is coming. And the ground is just filled with these scorpion-like creatures in some form of hibernation. So when this water hits them, these creatures just come to life. They come out of suspended animation, and the rain just, you know, just like kind of like the toads in Africa, or the lungfish. They encase themselves in this cocoon when it's really harsh and dry, and they don't come out again until it rains. So it's easy to buy that part of the movie. So Riddick knows this storm is coming. He knows what's coming out of this storm. He warns them, you know. I won't tell you how Riddick ends up, he does end up getting captured in the film, but, you know, he's warning these people, you know, you're going to be unchaining me in a moment because, you know, you guys are going to need my help, you're going to be dead, this storm's coming. And they're all in this outpost, they can't take off because Riddick's hidden their power nodes, and when the storm gets there, these creatures are unleashed. They have to free Riddick, they have to figure out a way to work together, and they have to get these power nodes. So, that's Chronicles of Riddick, but this film, Riddick, I really went into this film pretty much like I do with all films these days, with no expectations. I thought that the film would be entertaining and enjoyable, and on that aspect, guys, I really wasn't let down because, you know, it's a near 2-hour length movie. And I'm a big fan of Riddick himself, the character. I like Vin Diesel. And, you know, I think he's pretty much on par with the way he is in all the pitch black films. You have a secondary cast, which most of the characters in this movie are pretty uninteresting and dull. And, you know, you have the captain of this one ship, Johns, who's, you know, coming all the way out here to find out, you know, he doesn't want a bounty on Riddick. As a matter of fact, he tells him, I just want some information, and then you, Santana, you can have him. He just wants information about how his son died. But overall, even though, you know, you have some really good acting in the film, overall, the characters are just, they're just dull. They're not as interesting as they were in the first film. They're not as interesting as they were in the second film. In the third film, it's just you have some really, really dull characters. And I would actually have to put Riddick, if I was going to, you know, decide which films I like the best, it would be the first one, the second one, and then this one would be last. I think the second one is pretty underrated. And the third one gets back to basics. You know, you don't have all of this overblown religiously laced storyline that's in the second film, which, you know, kind of turned me off a little bit, just the whole epic scope of the film, because I'm thinking, this is a character like Riddick. Do we really need all these religious overtones? But the film has grown on me. But this one goes back to basics, where you have just Riddick fighting off creatures, trying to defend himself against mercenaries. So you have a pretty simplistic story. And when I saw the trailers of the film, my first thought was, and this was after I'd seen Man of Steel when I saw this trailer, after being hugely disappointed with that film, I kind of grew a little bit faithful in the fact that, you know, well, this is Riddick, you know. How can you not mess that film up? And I got to say, guys, that they did not mess the film up. I would say it's pretty basic. It's pretty much just the a retelling of the first film. Really, it's just a retelling of the first film, in my opinion. But at the same time, guys, it didn't offer anything new. It didn't offer really any character development to Riddick. I mean, this will be the third film that Riddick's been in, and you really don't learn a whole lot about this character. You really don't discover anything new about him. You have mercenaries that are joining the fray, and they're really uninteresting. None of the characters are compelling. And what's really kind of strange to me that David Twohy, who knows this character inside and out, Riddick himself is really kind of shallow in this film. I mean, you know, he still delivers the goods. You know, he's still just as a badass as he always is. But at the same time, there's not a lot of depth with this character. He definitely hasn't grown by this third film. And you would think that wouldn't be the case. I mean, his motivations at the beginning of the film are that he just wants to go home. He wants to find his people. He wants to see if any of them are left. But as far as the character is concerned himself, he's written very, very shallow. And the film, you know, the creatures in the film, they're not very, you know, in the first film, when I was watching the first film, when we had these creatures in there, I was thinking, man, these things are badass. I mean, they were literally scary. They were literally, I mean, when you saw these creatures, you knew you better run because you're not going to beat them. But in this film, the creatures are a little bit of a letdown. They're not as menacing. All the tension that was in the first film is totally gone because you have a danger here that is not much of a threat. And then the mercenaries themselves, as far as them being dangerous and actually catching Riddick, the whole film has this flavor that, you know, they're not a threat either because, you know, Riddick can kick their asses. I mean, and Riddick is just so cool and calm, you know, it's not a big deal, you know, you guys are going to end up dead. So, you know, there's really not a threat in this movie. But at the same time, it follows a formula, the same formula that the first film followed. There's just nothing new in the film. There's nothing inventive in the film. And I got to admit that I expected a little bit more from Twohy, who's done these films since day one. But he stays, pretty much sticks to the original formula, makes a film that doesn't offer any surprises. Doesn't offer anything new. We see Riddick fighting creatures again and Riddick fighting mercenaries again, trying to get off this planet, the same exact formula that was Pitch Black. So while I enjoyed the film, there definitely was room to make a little bit more as far as improvements go. There was definitely they should have strayed off the familiar path and went in another direction and did something different. They definitely should have tried to do something different. And that's probably Pitch Black, or that's probably Riddick's biggest mistake, is that it stayed too faithful to the original film and didn't stray off the path at all. But I did like the film, and that's mostly due to Vin Diesel himself. I did like the film. I did like the Riddick character. But if you're stepping into the world of Pitch Black for the first time, this definitely isn't the best film in the franchise to have a look at. But anyway, would say if you're a fan of the series, check it out, but don't expect a whole lot as far as anything new. A little bit of gore in the film. I mean, it's R-rated. You do see a decapitation, people getting sliced up, but I mean, if you compare it to Judge Dredd, as far as its R rating goes and the violence in that film, it's nowhere near on the level of Judge Dredd. It's nowhere near that as intense. Now, this film, not intense. No tension, no scares. Monsters aren't scary. Too true to Pitch Black. But Pitch Black did it much better. Thanks for watching, everybody. Take care, and I'll see you at the next movie review.